Hallelujah. Wesley L. Dwell wrote a song. I really don't know the melody, but it says, "Come, oh come, we plead. Blessed Holy Spirit, come again today. Come indwell us fully in a mighty way. We're longing, we're waiting for your grace and power. Blessed Holy Spirit, come on us this hour. Come on us now. Come on us now. Hungry, thirsty, longing before you, we bow. Work in all your faithfulness in and through us all. Hungry and obeying, Lord, in faith we call. Blessed Holy Spirit, let Shekinah fall. May your holy glory come upon us all. May your fire and your glory now on us descend. Put your seal upon us, that in service send. Blessed Holy Spirit, work so all can see. Exercise your lordship, all your ministry. Work in power more fully than we've seen or heard, till your blessed promise, 'tis your holy word. Blessed Holy Spirit, oh, do not delay. Come in might and glory, come on us today. 'Tis for you we hunger, it is you we need. Blessed Holy Spirit, come, oh come, we plead. More of you. An outpouring of my glory, mightier than the sea, covering the earth. It will show my worth. Even the heathen will cry out. Those set against me will bow. For I will display my glory. Oh, not as an act to show off, to make a show, to make a display. No, but that there might be a holy fear. Come on. Mankind, my creation, that they might turn to me, that they might turn from their wicked ways and turn to me, that I might heal them and gather them unto myself as my own, for I would that none be lost. Though so many reject me at such a great cost, yet will I reach out once more and open wide heaven's door and beckon all to come in, to come in, to come in, to come in. door is shut and it's too late. So go and tell them it's really not the time to wait. Glad you're all here tonight. Bless you. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Pastor Lou is on the ground in New York, staying with his brother John. Going to get on the plane tomorrow. I mean, on the train tomorrow, and go on up to northern New York and be with his parents for a week. And he sends his love, and he's looking forward to seeing us all. Amen.
Hallelujah, I greet you all tonight in the name of our Savior. Good to see you tonight. Well, in 2 Corinthians 9:6, it says, "But this I say, he who soweth sparingly shall also reap sparingly, and he who soweth bountifully shall also reap bountifully. Every man according as he purposed in his heart, so let him give, not grudgingly or of necessity, for God loves a cheerful giver." You've all heard the phrase, penny pinching and pound crazy. But a lot of times, all of a sudden, when it comes time to offering time, and when we get our paycheck and it's time, a lot of Christians, they become penny pinching, but blessing hungry. They want God to continue to pour out the blessings on them, but when it comes to their pocketbook, now all of a sudden, it's a different story. Let's purpose in our heart to sow bountifully, because we will reap bountifully in so many areas, in such a large capacity, so that we would always have it in our heart, the purpose to give, because our living is by our giving. And it's just, you know, God changes our lifestyle. He changes everything. Like I had mentioned once before, when we start tithing, when we give of our offerings, we enter into a whole different dimension of God's blessing. There's just a whole different dimension in the spiritual world that we enter into. We open ourselves up to receive the blessing, but that's because we have not been chintzy, we've not been penny pinching, we have just openly given bountifully. Ron, if you would, please. Father, and I praise you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you. Thank you. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord.
Thank you so much.
Well, he's here. I'm glad I'm here. If he's here, that's where I want to be. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Matthew chapter 8. We'll start out there anyway. Praise the Lord. Who knows where we'll go? Matthew chapter 8. Verse 14 and 15. Matthew 8, verse 14 and 15. There you are. And when Jesus was come into Peter's house, he saw his wife's mother laid and sick of a fever. And he touched her hand, and the fever left her. And she arose and ministered to them. You don't see him fasting and praying before he meets the need. Do you? Huh? He didn't get before God and cry out, "Oh Father, what should I do? Is it your will to heal her?" Did he? You hear a lot of foolishness out and about. He just knew it was God's will to heal her. God is Jehovah Rapha, the one that stitches up, binds up, and heals. That's who God is. That's his nature. His nature doesn't change. If God ever reveals to us any part of his nature, we should be able to stand in faith on that revelation no matter what. Because God doesn't change. I said, God doesn't change. Jesus, same yesterday, today, forever. It doesn't change at all. See, it had to be God's will for Peter's mother-in-law to be healed and whole. Because that's according to the nature of God. Jesus knew that. He didn't have to pray about it. He didn't have to go up on the mountain. Now, I understand. He had communion with the Father. He knew the Father. And he knew the Word. He was a student of the Word of God, what was available at the time, the oral tradition, all that stuff. But you and I can come to the same conclusion ourselves, if we will, just by studying the Gospels. For example, how many people did Jesus walk up to and make sick? I curse you with... No, he never did that, did he? I mean, it's laughable, I know. But the way people act sometimes, you've got to wonder if they didn't read that somewhere. Where did they get their ideas from? It certainly wasn't out of the Bible with them. Huh? How many people did he tell, "This sickness is all for the glory of God. This is all for the glory of God. So keep it a while." I understand. He did tell one that the condition was for the glory of God because he was there to heal, to deliver. That was what brought God glory, certainly not the sickness. But he didn't say, "You're going to have to hang on to this for a little while longer to glorify God." I've had people tell me, "Well, I'm just suffering for Jesus." They're not suffering for Jesus. They're not out being maligned and mocked and persecuted for their faith or their testimony. They're just sick because they're going through it. That's all for the glory of God. Well, I understand that when you're not feeling good and when you're under the weather and when you are sick or when you are wounded, there is a going through in faith But you're certainly not blaming God for the mess you're in. You're looking to Him to heal you because He's the healer, which is really obvious, even in this fallen world, with all of our bodies, everything in creation is groaning and travailing, waiting for the redemption of the sons of God. And even the sons of God, all of us human beings, are just, we're feeling the effects of sin. We're aging. We can tear muscles. We can break bones. There's just all kinds of things that come at us. But even in the midst of the fall, our basic design is to heal ourselves. The body goes to work when infection comes and fights it. If our immune system is working right, we never notice how many bad guys they beat off in a day. Now, you can't breathe this air and not have a problem unless your immune system is working. You certainly couldn't be a physician and walking around, or a nurse and walking around in the hospitals and all of this, and expect to catch nothing unless your immune system is really working. We're designed to heal. That's why we should just be sold out for healing.
Amen.
How many people who wanted healing did He turn down? None. None. How many times did He say, "No, I can't heal you. I'm sorry. This is not your time." I mean, even where there was no faith in His own hometown, He goes in there and He could do no mighty works because of their unbelief, and yet He healed a lot of sick folks. It's just the nature of God. I think being a doctor, being a nurse, being, you know, somebody that works in the healing field, that's got to be awesome, man, because you're joined together with God in His plan and His purpose to heal. I think psychiatrists, psychologists, if they're Christian and they really understand, I guess pastors and, you know, caregivers, these guys, they're all geared to manifest the healing of God in other people's lives. Why? Because God is a healer. Aren't you glad of that? Huh? How often did He say, being lost and separated from God is a good thing for you? Just get out there and get yourself beat up a little bit by the devil, and the longer you're out there, the better it's going to be for you. I mean, really, huh? He didn't, did He? Never. See, because Jesus, every move in His earthly ministry was the will of God in action. See, and if we're Christians, we're supposed to be Christians, and there's a lot of people in the country that say they're Christians. Wouldn't it just seem right that each one was attempting to be like Christ so the world could see Jesus? Amen? I mean, even in our messed up state, imperfect state, whatever you want to call it, we can walk in this wonderful thing called grace. We're washed in the blood. We're the righteousness of God in Christ, and He is perfecting us along the way. We don't have to wait to get ready. We can just begin to move and flow with Him and demonstrate the love of God and the power of God to humanity. So when we see Jesus never turned anyone down, it tells us God never turns anybody down. At least that's the logic I see in it. If He doesn't turn anybody down, will He turn you down? Will He turn me down? Will He turn anybody down? If He never did it, why would He? He's no respecter of persons. Isn't that what Scripture says? No respecter. One person is not more important to Him than anybody else. He loves each individual as much as He loves Jesus. Oh, hallelujah. Jesus never said wait. Does that mean God never waits? Well, we think so, because things don't happen on our time schedule, and yet God says, before you pray, the answer's on the way. Before you even open your mouth. He sounds the depths of our heart. He knows our thoughts. The devil can't, thank God, but God does. And he says the answer's on the way even before you ask. Now, he expects you to ask, but he already knows you're going to ask, so the answer's already on the way. I just, you know, God is awesome. God is good all the time. Huh? Jesus never said, this sickness is good for you, so God never says this sickness is good for you. Jesus did nothing but set people free, therefore God does nothing but set people free. The real foundation, the essence of America is freedom. Where'd that come from? God. That's where it came from. That's why we became a great nation. In spite of our imperfections and everything else, we had this, we'd caught the idea that God sent Jesus to liberate people. And the first settlers, for the most part, were people who were coming to experience freedom in Christ and gave birth to a great nation, which I pray will not be torn apart by those that don't understand who God is and how great it is, this wonderful, wonderful, wonderful land and idea, concept, principle that we have. So Jesus is really all the proof we need to know that God's will is to heal, deliver, and save everybody. That's his will. He would that none be lost. He spoke that to us a little earlier. He takes no pleasure in the death of the wicked. And he's wanting us to catch the heart cry of the lost, catch the heart cry of the suffering, catch the heart cry of the dying. And then not let it overwhelm us, because we're only one person, each of us, and we can only influence so many people and reach so many people. But if we could just do what we can do, I think that's what God would want us to do. But we've been, I believe, the church, you and I, we've been lied to, deceived, lulled into slumber when it comes to our place in the body of Christ. And that is the danger of religion. I mean, we've got churches today, people don't get born again. I mean, it's crazy. They have great services. They got lots of lights. They got smokes. They got mirrors. They got, I don't know, you know, programs up the yo-yo. But it's kind of like, well, if you get saved, it's almost by accident. Something's wrong with that. If that's really what Jesus came to seek and to save, that which was lost. Religion would rather debate about healing than see somebody healed. And I'm not saying I've never thought religiously, because I have. I try to figure out how all this stuff works. I don't know if that's just the carnal man, I guess. But with the inability to figure out how it works, we've got to be careful that then we don't begin to believe it doesn't work because we can't understand it and can't figure it out. When God is God. Amen? Religion would rather argue about deliverance than see somebody really delivered and set free. And I don't have a problem referring somebody who has a chemical imbalance in their body to a doctor to get that, or a psychiatrist, get that straightened out, help them get on their feet, get going. But, you know, I'd a lot rather if we just laid hands on them or we just prayed for them and they were instantly healed. And I have seen that too. the results, we just need to do what the Word tells us to do and leave the results up to God. Quit thinking so much about it all. Christ is in you. Christ is in me. What does that mean? What does that imply? That means that we should be the anointing, the yoke-destroying, the yoke-decimating, burden-removing, death-defying, healing, delivering power of God is in you and I, whether we perceive it or not. It just goes with being a Christian. Doesn't it? It's awfully quiet in here. I don't know. Oh, hallelujah. Christ in you, the hope of glory. Woo! My God, he's in us. Healing's in us. Deliverance is in us.
Amen.
I know how frustrating it is when you just, you know you've got it, and you're wondering why somebody won't just take it. But that is not our problem. That's where we get into, we're trying to figure it all out. We need to quit trying to figure it out. Just go ahead and minister to people and then let the chips fall where they may. Because God, we can't heal anybody, but God is the healer. We can't deliver anybody, but God's the deliverer. We can't comfort anybody, but God is the comforter. And so we just need to let go and let God. Jesus said in John 14:12, truly, truly, I say unto you, he that believes on me, the works I do, shall he do. That ought to be enough. That's more than enough. That's hard enough to get our mind wrapped around, but then he goes on and finishes up in there and it says, but you'll do, not only shall you do these things, but you'll do greater works. He was talking about you and I. I'm ready for that to break forth in the body of Christ, aren't you? I mean, something needs to get unhinged so the door will fall off or something, you know. When will we start? When will we dare to believe? When will we act? Why is this power in us? So you and I can demonstrate resurrection. You and I are supposed to be a demonstration of the resurrected Christ on earth today. Amen? The Chinese, gotta love the Chinese. We better love them. There's an awful lot of them. Amen? Huh? But the Chinese tell those that have just received Christ, today you have become the eyes of Jesus. Today you have become the hands of Jesus. Today you have become the feet of Jesus. You have become the mouth of Jesus. You have become a member of the body of Christ. Now go do what Jesus did. And man, they are. They are. I mean, those young teenagers over there just embarrass me. I mean, when we were over there, we're smuggling Bibles into them and all of that, and this house church leader comes. He's 18 years old. No, he was 23. He had 1,000 house churches under him. One of his leaders that had 100 under him was only 18 years old. He was with him. At risk of going to prison, they came into our hotel room, and he said, you know, there's a dialogue going on. Our interpreter, I said, well, you know, we greeted them, and we're trying to be as friendly as we can without speaking the language, and they're just so thrilled because we brought them the Word of God and teaching materials, and, you know, it's kind of like, wow, God, you're really good letting us do that. But to them, it's like we were the hand of God. We were the feet of God. We, you know, and this guy, he says, I want you to pray for me, and I looked at him like he was insane. I said, I want you to pray for me. And that was one of the most powerful experiences of my life, because he laid hands on me and I laid hands on him. We both wound up on the floor. It was awesome. Crying, bawling, squalling, hugging each other. Oh man, it was awesome. We're so soft here, I guess. We're just so comfortable. And we're beginning to see what it's costing us. But this great truth is often overlooked or downplayed by the American church. We are the hands, the feet, the mouth, the eyes of Jesus. I don't know what the statistics are now. The last time I looked, there was only about 25% or one quarter of the so-called born-again Christians that share their faith with others. That's about how many vote, too. It's just really amazing. But it's because religion is arguing about whether it's right or not. I mean, give me a break. And we have, of course, secular humanists and communists and Marxists and everybody else telling us, well, you need to keep your faith to yourself. Keep it in your four walls. Don't bother us with it. And for the most part, a lot of the church is saying, that makes sense. Okay. I don't want to offend anybody. But the gospel's offensive. Jesus is offensive. Not that he did anything offensive, and not that the word has anything in it that's offensive. It's all good. It's powerful. It's living. It's life-giving. But how can this be when the scripture clearly commands in Mark 16, 15 through 20, he said unto them, go into all the world and proclaim or preach or declare the gospel to every creature. He that believes and is baptized shall be saved. He that believes not shall be damned. I wonder if we understand what damned means. There is a hell, an eternal hell, that also much of the church has just decided, well, that can't really be literally a lake of fire, a place of torment that's eternal. I mean, surely a loving God wouldn't send anybody to a place like that. No, he's not. He's crying out, stay away from there. I want you in heaven. I want you with me. But the devil's going there. That's who it was made for. And everybody that follows him by rejecting Christ, which is really what they're doing, is going to wind up where he is. And somehow we've got to care more. He that believeth not shall be damned. These signs shall follow them that believe. In my name they'll cast out devils. That's fun, by the way. They shall speak with new tongues. They shall take up serpents. Original language, they shall take up that old serpent. In other words, we actually have authority over that old serpent, Satan himself. Now, I realize some people have just taken this and, you know, handled snakes and stuff. That's not what we do. And the text really doesn't bear that out. Wow. And if they drink any deadly thing, it shall not hurt them. And if they shall lay hands on the sick, and they shall recover. We should be more surprised when people don't recover when we touch them than if they do. What? You didn't get healed? I can't believe it. We realize it's not us, it's Jesus. It's Christ in us. So then after the Lord had spoken to them, he was received up into heaven, sat down on the right hand of God. That means, okay, I'm done with my part now. You do your part. And they went forth, preached everywhere, proclaimed everywhere, declared everywhere. The Lord working with them. We're never alone. God is always with us. And confirming the word with signs following. We do what the word of God says, and God will confirm it with signs following. People will get saved. People will get baptized in the Holy Ghost. People will get healed. People will get delivered. People will be comforted. The insane will be in their right minds. And I'll never forget early on, Sharon just almost immediately found herself teaching a woman's class for our church. Pastor Bill Sharp was the pastor, and he just had her take over the women's ministry. And women were coming. In fact, Juanita Williams used to drive all the way from Los Angeles, where she lived, to come to her meetings and then drive back the next morning, every week. That's how we wound up, you know, eventually she became a part of us. And, you know, so, and there were a lot of ladies there, and they, I'll never forget this one, and there was one guy, Bill Hewitt, great guy, he lives, I don't know, he's up in Oregon, Washington, somewhere now, and he used to drive school bus, and so he was off when she was teaching, and he would come and lay behind the curtain in the back of the room so nobody could see he was there, and he'd listen to the teaching and take notes. It was funny. A hunger for God. I mean, that's the thing. There's such a hunger there. And he was amazing. He couldn't read, and yet he drove a school bus because he just had somebody take him on the route, and he memorized every corner, every street, every stop. Just boom, 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 boom. So it wasn't that he wasn't smart. He just couldn't read. Couldn't read his Bible. But he would sit here and he'd just open it up and say, read that. For God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten son. Okay, now read that. For all of sin comes short of the glory. He knew where every verse was, but he couldn't read them. He could quote them because he'd heard them. Hungry for God. It was amazing. But anyway, so Sharon's ministering to these ladies, and the ladies bring her this one great big lady. and she's looking at this lady, right? And she lays hands on her, prays for her. Well, come to find out, what was she? She was a murderer, right? And she was insane. And they just gave her to Sharon. God delivered her. Boom, right there. That lady got born again, straightened her life out. Well, how do you know when that's going to happen? Another lady, I don't know, you got connected with some other lady, you were a psych nurse or at one time, and I don't know how it all worked. Some lady was in lockup, and I mean, she'd been in there several times. She was just nuttier than a fruitcake, you know, and just hallucination. It was terrible, tormented, human being. And somehow or other, Sharon got to talking to her on the phone, got her saved on the phone, I think it was her. Led her to Christ. Then she led her to the baptism of the Holy Spirit. So this lady would pray in tongues, and when she did, she'd have control of her mind. She could think. She quit praying in tongues, and all the tormentors would come after her. Now, when she got born again, it had quieted down some. It was better. But when she'd get attacked, she'd start praying in tongues, just walking her room or walking the halls, whatever they'd let her do, pray in tongues, and her mind would come back and just settle in peace. Year and a half, 2 years later, we saw her at the corner of Sahara and Paradise. She jumped up, ran over, hugged Sharon, and says, you don't even remember me, do you? Nice looking lady and, you know, well kept. She says, you don't remember me, do you? I'm Sister So-and-so. You led me to Christ when I was in lockup. You know, the mental ward. She says, you got me praying in tongues. She says, I have been in my right mind for a year and a half at that time, wasn't it? And just life is good. Woo! See, that's what I'm talking about. Well, what about the times you pray for somebody and nothing happens? It's none of our business. It's his business. And there's a time and a season for everything if we'll just be about the Master's business. Amen. See, this is what you and I were saved for. This is what pleases the Father. He said in Ezekiel 34:16, I will seek that which was lost and bring again that which was driven away, and I will bind up what was broken, and I will strengthen that which was sick. Old Testament promise. How will he seek the lost? How will he bring again that which was driven away? How will he bind up that which was broken? How will he strengthen that which was sick? You and me! See, that's what gives vitality to being a Christian, is being engaged in just letting Jesus use us. We're the feet, we're the hands, we're the heart, we're the mouth of God. And I realize every person is unique, every person is used differently and in different environment and different places, but the key is really to just say, Lord, if you can use me, use me. And then be open to it, wherever you are. And he will rock you because there's no limitations in the Spirit. They must be checking in. That's good. Our computer is connected with the Geek Squad somewhere over the internet, and they're going to go through and try and fix it for us. And so they're working on it. Satan receives a seed of power as each Christian that does not know that he or she is commissioned to reach the lost by means of the Word of God, the blood of Jesus, and their testimony. We have the Word of God. We have the blood of Jesus. We have the Word of our testimony. And the Word of our testimony is mingled with the blood of the Lamb and destroys the work of the devil. It's pretty simple. God's doing it all. We may think Satan has lost his seat of power in the heavenlies, but that's really not it. He's on earth. He's seeking whom he may devour. Right now, he's got a lot of people listening to him. You know, some people think Satan has this big throne in hell. Excuse me. There's no party there. It's a jail cell, and a hot one at that. Hell is a place of torment specifically designed for Satan and the fallen angels. It was never meant for humanity. But if humanity follows Satan, that's where they'll wind up. We may think Satan has a seat of power in music. Well, he sure manages to control a lot of things, it seems like. We may think his seat of power is in pagan or satanic worship, in secular humanism, in Islam. But no, he gains some power through these means, but he doesn't have his seat of power there. The seat of Satan's power is in the church that doesn't reach out to others for Christ in the power of the Father's love. That's his greatest deception. That's his greatest place of power. And he is attacking the church worldwide with all he's got in him, both from without and from within. And Ephesians 4:27 says, don't give place to the devil. We should be a people that know their God and do exploits. Right? Daniel 11:32. And such as do wickedly against the covenant shall he corrupt by flatteries. Well, that's what's going on. Okay, whole lot of ego stroking these days. A whole lot of back patting among the wicked. But, the people that do know their God shall be strong and do exploits. Praise God. So let's demonstrate the power of God by snatching the lost out of the clutches of Satan, break the power of death, hell, and the grave, plunder hell. I love it. Reinhard Bonnke, you're going down to see him, I guess, here in a couple of weeks, and this is his phrase. Let us plunder hell and populate heaven. I love that. Plunder hell and populate heaven. Hallelujah. We're the king priests of earth. Revelation 1:6, he's made us kings and priests unto God and his Father. To him be glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. And Revelation 5:10, and he's made us unto our God kings and priests. We shall reign on earth. This is our divine calling. This is our divine destiny, is to reign in our places of influence. It's education, medicine, religion, you know, construction. I don't care what it is. To bring the light of the gospel and the power of the gospel. You know, I'd get so thrilled when I'd hear of Joey having Bible studies in the casinos, you know, with the sound people and the musical groups. I mean, that is awesome. In the charismatic renewal, there was something like that going on in almost every hotel, every casino, every show in town. It's going to happen again. It's going to happen again. If it's not happening already. Hallelujah. It's our calling to go into the world and conquer for our King. And where we get into trouble is when we don't do what we're called and commissioned to do. And maybe that's why there's so many ministers and ministries falling. Are they like King David, who should have been out engaged in the war, leading his troops, or at least out there with them and you know? And yet he's walking around in the comfort of the palace, goes out for a breath of fresh air, and the devil's got him all set up. There's Bathsheba, taking a bath. One thing leads to another, and it leads not just to fornication, not just to an adulterous kind of a relationship, but to murder. That could be the problem. Most likely is. There was one minister, young minister, I got a kick out of him. He used to be a gangbanger. He was a gang leader, one of the more prominent gangs, drugs, prostitution, you know, he ran all kinds of that stuff. Anyway, he got born again, and he used to be known as quite a womanizer and quite a partier. And one of his friends asked him one day, they said, hey, preacher, he says, how do you keep from sinning? He says, man, I am so busy with the work of the Lord, I don't have time to sin. I thought that is a good way to go. David got in trouble when he didn't do what his position as a king demanded. We're kings and priests. When he sent others to do what he should have been doing himself. Remember Joab and the servants and all Israel. When he stayed where it was peaceful and comfortable. When he was where he shouldn't have been, when his attention was on the wrong thing, Bathsheba instead of the enemies of God. David, the man after God's own heart, oh my, gave Satan a seat of power in his life. And it did cost him. Kings go forth to battle. You go forth from the church to work, to the workplace, to conquer and to take spoil. And whether you know it or not, when you bring your tithe, you bring your offering, what you're doing is you're bringing the spoil into the kingdom. Because Jesus really is Melchizedek. Jesus is receiving the tithe and the offering. But we, every time we go out into the world and we get gain, we're taking spoil. Praise God. And we're supposed to conquer. We're with people that are hurting, all messed up. And we snatch them out of the devil's grasp and compel them to come in. It's our first place of ministry. At work, you meet the enemy as he works in people's lives. But you're anointed to set the captives free. The victory was won at the cross of Calvary. So that's already done. So the lost are saved and the sick are healed and the oppressed are relieved. Praise God. Hallelujah. No one has the influence you have with your peers. It never ceases to amaze me the tremendous influence a teacher has. And I've seen this before, but I've really seen this in Pastor Lou's life, because he works as a godly teacher, and it's just so obvious. But that place, position of influence, draws the young to him. And he's led many, many, many to the Lord. And they didn't all wind up here, and he's not real happy about that, neither am I. But we're thrilled because many of them are going on with the Lord. They're on mission teams now, and they're serving churches all over the valley. No one has their ear like you have. No one can reach them but you. And we've seen that. I mean, your influence where you are, eventually people wind up here at least taking a look. At least weighing their options. See, some water, right? Some sow, some water, some fertilizer. And some get to reap. Amen. No one hears their complaints like you do. No one hears their pain like you do. And no one knows when they're sick when you do. And so God positions you. And you have to remember Isaiah 61:1. The Spirit of the Lord God is upon me. Did Jesus read that? Jesus applied it to himself. And if Christ is in us, that same anointing is ours. I think we need to stir up the gift that's within us. We need to keep being refreshed and reminding ourselves, the Spirit of the Lord God is upon me, because the Lord has anointed me to declare good tidings to the meek, sent me to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives, and the opening of prison to those that are bound. It's to announce glad news, to be a messenger, to show, to display out of our lives, to publish, to carry, to tell the good tidings. Because God is good all the time. Luke 4:18, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he has anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor, sent me to heal the brokenhearted, preach deliverance to the captives, recovering of sight to the blind, set at liberty them that are bruised. Christ, the anointed one, his anointing in you. Christ, the anointed one, and his anointing in you. And that same Spirit that raised Christ from the dead, resurrection, the Spirit of resurrection life, dwells in you. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Father, we thank you. Stir within us, Lord, a holy zeal. And open our eyes to opportunity in the mighty name of Jesus. Let us be salt and let us be light. And the more the darkness, the brighter the light, that many might be saved. For you are going to display your act, your strange act, all over this planet that has shrunk to such a small size. And we thank you and we praise you for it. For there's nothing that can be done anywhere. Even the liberal media can't cover it up. When you begin to break forth on humanity, it'll spread like wildfire. And we give you praise and honor and glory, and ask, Lord, here we are, use us. Here we are, Lord, use us. You said, ask of you and you'd give us the nations. And we're asking. And we thank you for it. In Jesus' name. Let your anointing just be stirred fresh and new upon each one that's here. And yes, the rest of our church members that are not here, Lord, bless them, anoint them, stir them by your Spirit for this great hour. Demonstration of your power in the face of a haughty and a mocking enemy. In Jesus' name, amen.
Join us for services at Wellspring Church of All Nations, a dynamic church that lifts up the name of Jesus. We are meeting at 4870 Janelle Drive, located between Buffalo and Durango, with an entrance at 8140 West Lone Mountain Road. Our focus is to win the lost, connect them to Jesus and His church, train them in the Word of God, and help them find their place in the work of the Lord. Our service times are 10:45 a.m. and 6 p.m. on Sunday and 6:30 p.m. on Wednesday. For more information, you can give us a call at 702-631-5027. That's 631-5027. Or you can visit our website, www.wellspringministries.com.